Hi, today I'm going to present our fabrication project and how we use this printing on fabric technique to create architectural models. The practice of architectural model making was our inspiration, as it's a powerful way to explore ideas about shape in the ideation phase of the design process, where the shapes are not always accurate, but they help convey ideas about the architectural form that we're going for. Oftentimes, the way a model is built and the materials chosen for this model have an impact on the final design. One such technique that we think could spark interesting design ideas is self-shaping textiles. The idea is to take this very common and convenient material in architecture, which is fabric, and to engineer it in such a way that it self-deploys into shape. Usually, self-shaping textiles are able to automatically pop out because they are fabricated from pre-stretched fabric, so you can think of them as a special kind of tensile structure. Here are two architectural examples, a sunshading structure by Kisia and a suspending ceiling by Burdos and their colleagues. These examples demonstrate that even though we focused on fabricating small-scale architectural models, it is possible to create larger structures. A common technique to create self-shaping textiles is to bind two layers of material so as to create a composite structure. One layer consists of a stiff material which resists actual strain, and the other layer is a pre-stretched fabric material. The presence of the material will partly obstruct the full release of the fabric from its stretch, causing the whole assembly to buckle out of plane. For example, looking at this sunshading structure on the left, we can see that the potato chip shape of the circular components is a result of the pre-stretched fabric being enclosed by a semi-rigid piece of plastic around its boundary. A particularly simple way to create self-shaping textiles is a process that we call printing on fabric. The idea is to clamp a piece of fabric onto the build plate of a 3D printer. Here we use a frame to maintain uniform pressure on the fabric so that it doesn't move, and let the printer deposit plastic curves onto the fabric. The molten plastic will naturally bind with the fabric, so there's no additional process required. The technique was introduced by designers Christophe Gubran and Carlo Clopath, which they used to create a self-shaping shoe. Now, it can be difficult to predict the result of a given pattern, so a certain amount of trial and error is required if you want to obtain a specific kind of result. Even though watching unexpected shapes rise up from the pattern you design can be a great way to explore how this material assembly behaves and what you can do with it, it would be more efficient to do computational form finding using a simulation-based tool, rather than doing many test prints and waste a lot of material and time in the process of doing so. There's been some work in trying to simulate the behavior of printing on fabric, most notably this paper which was presented at SIGGRAPH 2017, which specifically focused on the simulation of sparse patterns of closed curves, which gives rise to a specific class of geometries called Kirchhoff plateau surfaces, which is kind of reminiscent of the geometry of tensile structures. Instead of limiting ourselves to sparse patterns of closed curves, we looked at what happens when we print denser and more complex designs. And fortunately for us, several architects and designers experimented with this technique and organized workshops in fab labs, which resulted in the creation of a lot of fascinating and diverse shapes. What we find particularly interesting is that this density of patterns allows for the emergence of geometries that were not possible to achieve using sparse patterns of closed curves. In particular, dome-like shapes which have positive Gaussian curvature were impossible to reproduce using the previous method because they are not in the shape space of Kirchhoff plateau surfaces. These experiments inspired us to work with a dense pattern of our own making and to explore its possibilities using form finding. As a first step towards a better understanding of the behavior of these dense and intricate patterns, we decided to create a parametric design tool based on the styling of three-pointed stars, in which we can control the size of each individual star and the shape of its boundary. The position of each store stays fixed, but their sizes may vary, which allows us to play with the change of metric, as you'll see later. One particular quality of this pattern is its ability to naturally create convex domes with positive Gaussian curvature. Now, how does this work? Well, there's several effects that explain why three-pointed stars are well suited to create curvature when being printed on fabric. First, there's a local effect. At a scale of one star, what happens is that the fabric, while trying to go back to its original form, is bringing the branches closer together, which is not possible to realize in the plane. So the star will have to buckle out of plane to resolve this constraint. Then there is a global interaction between neighboring stars, which is due to the fact that they're all stuck to the same piece of fabric. And since this fabric has a finite thickness, the curvature of one star can sort of propagate to its neighbors through bending. We can also notice that since these stars have fixed positions on a regular grid, the bigger they are, the less space there is for the fabric to contract, since the plastic will prevent that compression from happening. This causes a local change of metric, meaning that the length on the surface will change, which is responsible for the assembly buckling out of plane into a specific curvature. So our goal for this project is to create a tool that will help users to design a specific layout based on this three-pointed star tiling. This tool will allow them to specify varying sizes for each star and a specific boundary around the layout as well. They will then be able to visualize the result of this layout using a form-finding tool so that they can iterate on their design until they're satisfied before printing it. In order to create this tool, we implemented our own simulation engine, which we precisely calibrated to be as predictive as possible. We then show how we can use this tool to create self-shaping architectural models. To design our patterns, we start from this tool where we can select stars and specify their dimensions. We can also add or remove some of them. Once we are happy with our layout, we can export on one hand the geometry to be printed, and on the other hand, the data to be used to run the simulation. Now let's take a look at the simulation. Starting from this layout, we run our in-house solver, which will iterate until finding static equilibrium. Since we know we want to pin some boundary points to the ground, we force the corresponding degrees of freedom to move iteratively, starting from their initial positions until they reach their final prescribed positions. The total time taken to run this simulation was about 20 minutes. To have a simulation engine which is as accurate as possible, we implemented several standard material models and we had to add some additional elements as well. First, we started by implementing the material models used in previous work by Perez and their colleagues. They used the discrete elastic rods model to simulate the plastic curves. They used a finite element model for the elastic forces in the fabric, and they coupled the two elements by just collocating the vertex positions. This combination of material models was not enough to reproduce what we observed in our printing experiments. We first had to add bending forces to the fabric. This allowed the fabric to propagate curvature between a star and its neighbors. And we also noticed what we call a bilayer effect. So what we mean by that is that when depositing rigid plastic into pre-stretched fabric, we create a phenomenon where the plastic wants to conserve its current length, whereas the fabric wants to restore its original smaller length. These contradictory forces will cause that assembly to curve up and assume a constant curvature kappa that we can compute from its geometry and its material parameters. We can even use this formula to calibrate our simulation engine. By printing plastic ribbons of a specific thickness and measuring the resulting curvature, we can deduce this ratio of Young's moduli, which is enough to describe the physics of our problem. We also noticed there was a phenomenon of plasticity involved. When we remove the plastic layer from the fabric layer, the plastic layer will not go back to its original flat geometry, but instead will assume a curvature kappa bar smaller than the initial bilayer curvature kappa. We modified our formula to take this plasticity into account as well. Finally, we can look at the impact of these two elements that we added to the simulation. On the left is what happens when we use the material models previously used by Perez and their colleagues. The stars only curve individually without any curvature propagating to the neighbors. When adding the fabric's bending, we are able to obtain something like a dome, but the result looks too rigid and the stars have trouble deciding whether they want to curve up or down since they have no preferred bending direction. Finally, adding that bilayer effect, we obtain something which is very close to the fabricated counterpart. Now, this example that I've shown you illustrates well the behavior of these structures and how they can behave differently depending on the constraints. Here, the shape that you see has actually its six corners pinned to the ground. But if we don't do that, something interesting happens. It will roll around itself like some kind of cigar. And this behavior likely happens because the size of the stars stays constant throughout the surface. So the applied metric is almost like the metric of a developable surface. Now, in general, for arbitrary designs, if we don't fix some boundary points to the ground, we will likely have weird and distorted shapes. So all the remaining examples have some points on their boundary fixed. This also gives us another way in which we can create varied shapes by choosing which points of the boundary will be fixed and where they will be fixed. After looking at constant size stars, we can look at what happens with stars with sizes varying from the center to the boundary. So here we have a comparison of three different rates of variation of star sizes. By having larger stars at the center than around the boundary, we can obtain some kind of dome shape. Now, if we change the rate of variation of these star sizes, we'll obtain different final geometries. When the star sizes decrease with a slower rate, which is what you can see on the top row, we obtain something like a hemisphere. But when the stars shrink more dramatically, they shrink faster at the start, which is what you can see on the bottom row, we obtain something which looks more like a cone. Now let's look at some results. We've seen before that if we print stars with a constant size, we'll have something that rolls into a cylinder. We can choose an elongated layout and fix four of its corners to the ground to obtain this kind of tunnel or tubular shape. We can also modify the star sizes so that the star at the center are bigger and the star on the boundary are smaller. And this way we'll decrease the amount of curvature induced and obtain something more like an arched roof. We also experimented with complex variations of star sizes, which allowed us to create doubly curved surfaces. The last shape even has some negative Gaussian curvature as well as positive Gaussian curvature. For this last shape, instead of pinning some corners to the ground, we used a textile hardener, which allowed this shape to be stiff enough to stand on its legs. To summarize, we created a design tool to experiment with self-actuated surfaces with a specific dense pattern of stars, which we found powerful enough to create interesting variations in shape, as well as simple enough to be used in a parametric manner, since we have only one varying parameter. We discovered a bilayer phenomenon, which turned out to have an instrumental effect in the behavior of our printed and fabric designs. For future work, we'd like to experiment with more varied patterns and designs. See, for example, the work of Kisia, who experimented with many different repeating patterns. Many of them might have a potential to be used in the same way as ours. We'd also like to develop an inverse design tool. If you want to target a specific geometry, instead of doing form finding in a trial and error fashion, it would be beneficial to find the optimal layout which would reproduce best a target geometry when printed. Thank you for your attention.